Well, Bernie, welcome on the podcast.
Thank you for having me.
It's a great, great pleasure. I was delighted when you joined the Sky F1 team, because as you know, I'm very interested anyway in the whole strategy side of Formula One. But what you bring is a real authenticity. I mean, having stepped literally straight off the Aston Martin pit wall and into the studio. First of all, how are you enjoying working on TV?
Yeah, it's very different. Well, thank you for all of that, first of all, but it's very different. It's not what I imagined. It's not what I set out to achieve when I left the pit wall, if we think of it like that. But I sort of took the opportunity and went for it. And I'm learning so much about, you know, a TV feed that came onto my pit wall in the past that I didn't really think about what went into making it. So that's been really interesting. I'm learning a lot about what fans are experiencing when they're watching Grand Prix. You know, I guess the most interesting thing was to step away from the pit wall and then watch the first Grand Prix at home on TV, you know, like everyone else does. So that was like a nice experience. And just sort of step back and enjoy all of it again rather than being solely focused on this one little bit.
And what's the reaction been like? I mean, I know what I think of it. I know what a lot of people I speak to think of it. They really enjoy the kind of the detail that you bring, explaining something quite complex in simple language, and obviously in real time as well, which is what makes it really exciting. But what kind of feedback have you had?
Yeah, no, I think the feedback from the general public has been amazing. I think people have really enjoyed having a bit more insight into what's happening, like you say, during the race, real time for the races that I'm there for. People enjoy the explanations before and after, and there's been a lot of discussion about, do I really have to work on making it in this simple language, or how I can best express what are sometimes complex problems. But actually, as an engineer on the pit wall, you spend a lot of time communicating, and a lot of what you do is communication. The thing that struck me the most, I think, is that actually when you step away from that engineering, you know, group of people and out of a team, and people move teams all the time, but when you really step away from it into TV, I was unsure how the reaction would be from an engineering standpoint. And actually, the feedback from the other engineers in the paddock has been quite positive as well. People have enjoyed an engineer's point of view being expressed in the way it is, rather than just, you know, someone saying, oh, you know, they're all idiots or whatever. They've quite enjoyed this sort of opening into the world of engineering that wasn't there before.
Formula One's a strange sport, isn't it, in many ways, because there's an awful lot going on in the sport that you can't really see just by looking at the TV pictures. And however expert the commentators may be, they aren't really inside all the decision making that's going on. There's layers of it, like an onion.
Yeah.
Is that kind of your mission, in a way, to give people a greater understanding of how the decision making that goes on actually really does lead to the outcomes?
Yeah, I think there's a few trains to it. One is the TV can, by its very nature, generally only shows us one image. Obviously, there's a lot of work going on, you know, with the onboards and stuff, but generally you see one image or one story or one snapshot of a story. And it's very difficult, because there's 20 cars making 20 different decisions, to build a good enough picture as to why we got to that overtake or why we got to that collision or whatever the case may be. So it's about trying to fill in a few of those blanks, first of all, because there's many stories happening at the same time. And often in a race where we just focus very much on the leaders, some of the actual midfield and background stories are as interesting. And, you know, those fights are as strong as they are for the win, because those points make such a difference to those, you know, mid or lower field teams. So there's that aspect of trying to broaden the story that we tell. And then there's the aspect of trying to give a little bit of insight as to, you know, a lot of us can look at the TV and go, oh, they were just, you know, undercut by another car, or they should have stopped one lap too early. Or I think, you know, the ones that often the people in TV at home can see the most is when it's raining or drying or whatever, and you think, oh, why would you possibly have done a different decision? So it is about trying to fill in some of those gaps a little bit and, yeah, give some insight into what's going on in the background. And one of the beautiful things that's come out of it is opening this world of engineering and data to people who never thought about that aspect of it before, and trying to encourage, you know, there's a lot of, not just younger people, but there's a lot of people out there becoming more data hungry than we've ever had before. So it's and it's working a bit with TV to see how do we show all that on one screen. That's quite complicated to show on one screen.
Yeah, but people do want to go beyond the obvious as they get more kind of, their fandom becomes more profound, you know, they want to go deeper into it. I'm interested, you've obviously written a book about your journey, how to win a Grand Prix,
yeah,
which tells the story of how you came from Northern Ireland to racing Formula Student, which is a, you know, a great pathway, a bit like F1 in schools, which is the forerunner of that for younger kids. And then ended up as an engineer at McLaren. I think one of your interesting aspects is that you came at it from an engineering point of view first, but other strategists I've known have come at it from a software background.
Yeah.
Mathematicians are very common.
Yeah, yeah.
There doesn't seem to be like a common profile that leads people to, there's 10 seats, 10 hot seats in Formula One for this person who's making these crucial decisions. And there doesn't seem to be like a single pathway to that.
Yeah, I think that is very true. And I think part of it is that, and I'm going to oversimplify, some of the strategists are going to be upset with this, but I'm going to oversimplify, like, a lot of what we base our decisions on are lap times. One lap time, take away another lap time, and some of the mathematics in that is reasonably simple. There's a lot of simulation and there's a lot of work goes on in the background of that and building an accurate model and stuff. But actually the most difficult bits I find of strategy, what makes the difference between a good strategist and a really, really good strategist, is the decision making under pressure, the communication with other people. You know, my route to strategy, like you say, being a mechanical engineer, you know, gearbox designer, performance engineer, strategist, is not the preferred route to get a good strategist. But that background meant I had a really good understanding of race teams and a really good understanding of getting the best out of a driver or the tires or the interaction on the engineering. And actually one of the bits that's the hardest to teach when you take on a new strategist is how you're working on this intercom full of voices, trying to get your voice heard at the right point, trying to hear the right things and make the right decisions with these snippets of information. That is a bit that's really difficult to teach. We get some really, you know, young, bright kids that are much brighter than I am in writing a piece of software or doing the mathematics behind it. But then it's that next bit of performing that in a qualifying, in a race situation, that's the bit that's hard to teach. And I think if you get this background in any of the other subjects, that's where it becomes really strong.
It's interesting because I was thinking about this before we met today. And actually, when you think about it, the strategist is a similar position as the two drivers, in that pretty much everyone else in the team, when the race is on, well, their actions are collective actions. So at the pit stops, it's everybody's thing. It's like it's a process, it's a routine. If someone makes a mess with a wheel go, it's not necessarily their mistake, it's a collective mistake. Whereas the drivers, they're carrying everyone's hopes individually, and so is the strategist. So you have like a commonality with them, that the pressure is really on you.
Yeah, and that's definitely one of the you feel that on the pit wall. You feel that. Obviously, the strategist is trying to work to get the best out of both drivers. You can't always achieve that. Sometimes there's decisions to be made there. But you are sort of, you feel like the last rung in the ladder, if you like. So a lot of people have gone into making a good car. Like you say, the pit crew have done like some good pit stop decisions, whatever the case may be. And then if you mess up the stop lap, all of that hard work in advance can be lost. And that's the bit I feel, you feel the pressure of the entire team that's gone before you. In getting that car on track and making it work, you know, and there's just so many little things going wrong. And that's the bit I always found it the hardest, when you felt you'd made a mistake getting off the pit wall and walking back through the garage full of guys that have done their job all right. And it is one of the other things I find very pressure with strategists is it's the one that's the easiest to criticize after the event. You know, we've all seen strategists make decisions on stop lap, and then one lap later a safety car comes out, or whatever the case may be, and it's evident that the stop lap was then could have been better. But you're trying to make decisions with the information you have at the time, and that's the bit. There was so many times, you know, when I rang home or whatever and Dad would go, oh, that was a mistake. I was like, okay, well, yeah, that's easy for you to say now. But there is that pressure.
It's interesting because obviously you can't do every race because you've also got a life to live, and you weren't unfortunately covering the Silverstone Grand Prix recently, because the reason Norris, well, and Piastri, but particularly Norris, didn't win that race, which probably could and should have done, was because of some strategy decisions. So they didn't double stack the cars, which hurt Piastri, and then they put Norris on the wrong tyre And obviously there's also a question mark about the stop lap that you come in on. Yeah. So it's a shame we didn't have your analysis of that, but that's a perfect example of what you're talking about there. And Ferrari over the last few, in recent years, I think Fred Vasseur's got a bit more of a grip now, but perhaps in the years before, were constantly being criticized for throwing away race wins. So it does play, I mean, it must presumably play on your mind a little bit if you make a mistake and maybe make another mistake maybe a month or two later. Do you start to doubt yourself? Do you start to, are you like a racing driver where you can just kind of throw it away and once you've analysed it?
Probably one of my strengths is that my memory's pretty poor. So actually post-race, I'm probably pretty good at, you know, moving on from it. But not, I think the most difficult ones are in race. During a race, when you make a poor decision, first of all, and then you feel like you're trying to climb out of that decision. And actually, that's the one where it's very hard to shake yourself off and just keep making good decisions. So, you know, in the Silverstone example, if you've got the stop lap wrong going onto the inner tire, then you feel even more pressure to get it right coming off the inner tire. And you can't obviously undone the mistake that's just been made. But post-race, how I dealt with it was I spent a lot of time going back and analysing it, figuring out what could have been different, what information was missed. I'd listen to the intercom, what I said, what others said, and try and really take away from it and then go into the next race. I think the Ferrari example is really interesting because I actually think one of the problems there, without having been on the pit walls, so I'm not speaking from a point of knowledge, but when you're making strategy decisions, when I was on the pit wall at Aston Martin, very rarely did some management get involved in those decisions. It was allowed full freedom largely to make those decisions. And sometimes they were wrong, sometimes they were right. But we went back and analysed that afterwards. I think previously what was happening was there was too many people involved in this committee of decision making. And that slows down the decision. And we see that time and time again. I think that's part of the issue with McLaren. When you're asking a driver continuously what tyre he wants, you slow down the decision process naturally. So the more independence you can have from the people making those decisions, the quicker those decisions will be naturally. And you know, a bit of Norris' stop lap thing is when he's so focused on is it a soft, medium or hard tire, he's not thinking if it's inter or dry. And actually the first question needed to be which lap is the right lap to put on the dry and let someone else deal with the other decision. And those are the teams that work the best together when you've got this trust and independent sort of thinking. And I was very lucky during my time in Aston that I had, you know, people at the end of the race being like, that was a mistake. But in the moment, you didn't feel like you had the pressure of the other people on your shoulders so much.
I was talking to somebody, someone senior in the McLaren setup recently after that race. And they said, they kind of consoled themselves with saying, you know, we're competitive, you know, and we're learning how to win. Mm-hmm. It's a kind of a new dawn for McLaren. Yeah. It's a new page, if you want, whatever way you want to look at it. And compared to teams like Red Bull and Mercedes, who've got like a culture of winning over a very long period of time, of which strategy decisions are a big part, they're sort of still learning how to do it. You know, in a way, Ferrari is kind of getting back to that. And you, you know, as Force India, Racing Point, Aston Martin, you were kind of like a challenger brand, weren't you?
Yeah, exactly.
Low budget, always punching above your weight. But Do you kind of buy into that mentality that a team like McLaren and the level they're at the moment, they're sort of learning to win?
Not really, to be honest. I sort of feel like, you know, McLaren, I feel like strategy in the midfield is as tough as strategy at the front. I mean, some will agree or disagree, but you're still fighting for every position, every point. McLaren in the past have been very good at strategy. I think there's been a little bit of movement of people there, a little bit on their pit wall. The people that you're playing against change. So as you're a midfield team or a lower midfield team, you're competing against certain teams and you get to know how their reaction and how aggressive they might be or whatever. And as you move up, obviously that changes. And obviously the level you're fighting against changes. So there is aspects of that. But I spent every race that I worked on analysing every decision that everyone else made. And I feel like I had a pretty good idea of why Red Bull were making decisions, why Mercedes were good. And I don't doubt that McLaren are doing the same. So you should, as you move forward, this is what you've been waiting for. This is what the whole team have been waiting for, this opportunity. And my panic always was, for example, in Force India, it's easy to always split the cars. It's easy to just do something different and cover all the bases. But actually, when you do that regularly, you forget how to be a good strategist. And actually, you need to just focus on when that car gets good, that you're in the best possible position you can be. And I think McLaren should be there. There's just, I think it's, it just seems like a bit of trust. And again, if we go back to Silverstone, Hamilton was told to box by the pit wall very early when Perez and Leclerc stopped from dry to inter, and he refused because of his knowledge and his experience. And that, we just need to build that a little bit and just get to that point, I think, with McLaren.
One of the things that's always been fantastic, I think, we want to see more women in prominent roles in Formula One. And one of the things that's always been terrific has been, there was you, there was Ruth Buscombe,
yeah,
who was at various different teams, Haas, she was at Sauber quite a few years, and obviously Hannah Schmitz, who's, yeah, on the pit wall at Red Bull. So you've had for quite some time prominent, females in prominent roles. So why is that, do you think? Is there a particular reason why that was a particular area in which women could come to the fore?
Yeah, it's interesting that, you know, I think at one point there was sort of close to 50% of the pit walls had a female strategist, at least at regularly at races. I guess there's a few, I guess one of the things that we discussed already, you know, the range of backgrounds that can feed into strategist. I don't think there's enough females in engineering, and therefore to get the 10 best on the pit wall, it's a struggle to have those as females. But there are probably more strategists doing software and mathematics and those types of things, and then more females, and therefore that filters into the pit wall. I think some of the aspects of decision making and pressure maybe lend themselves more to some of the females that are there. But also, it's one of the, and I don't know this for sure, and it wasn't necessarily the case for me, but it's one of the few roles that's regularly rotated. You know, Hannah rotates with Will, so it brings a little bit more balance, or whatever the case may be. Now, every race that Hannah's not doing, she is supporting for Mission Control in Milton Keynes, so it's not like she only does half of the races. But I think that group, that strategy group has sort of lent itself more to producing females that rise to the top in that. And I think it's a matter of time before that filters into other aspects of engineering. You know, I started out as a performance engineer, and without moving from McLaren, I would be trying to progress along that role towards race engineering. Now, we don't have any female race engineers, and hopefully that is just a matter of time. But I think the time that you put into becoming that voice for the driver is quite a commitment to F1. You know, people are sort of 10, 15 years at F1 before they reach that point. And maybe by that point, a lot of women have stepped away for other reasons. Whereas in strategy, I think some of that route is shortened.
So it's a very simplistic thing to think that maybe the multitasking aspect of the different things you need to be juggling in your head. Because people forget, you know, making decisions is one thing, but you're actually doing it in stereo.
Yeah.
Because, like, I remember talking a lot with James Vowles when he was the strategy engineer at, head of strategy at Mercedes, and he had Rosberg and Hamilton.
Yeah.
And of course, everybody had a view on whether one of them was being favoured or not. So having to do this stuff in stereo adds to another layer of the complexity.
It's massively complex, and it's one of my worries is that if I went back to the pit wall now, but I'd be fit to deal with all that information, because we literally have one driver in our left and one in our right. That's how we split it up. And you know, that's not to be clear, there's a number of really great male strategists they're lining up the pit walls. You know, Will at Red Bull as well. You know, you can't tell the difference between the races that him and Hannah produce. But it just, something about that group and the route into that group has produced more female, you know, a much stronger ratio male to female than what we have in the rest of the grid, really.
I'm interested in your book. There's a number of kind of descriptions of different characters that you've worked with and what have you.
Yeah.
But I'd love to know, you know, who you feel is the sort of hardest working driver that you work with in your time, and also which driver do you think really got it the most when it comes to strategy?
That's a tough question, but I think that's probably the same answer for both, actually. I think the person who was the hardest working was probably Sebastian Vettel, in that he was very relentless in terms of looking for improvement, particularly when he first joined us, looking for improvement, where things could be found. Probably actually quite a close tie between him and Esteban Ocon. Ocon had, you know, quite a hard into F1 and really, really wanted it to work. So those two actually worked quite hard, I think, in the background. the person who understood strategy the most that I've worked with, I would say, is Sebastian. You know, but, and I think that comes down to experience. He understood what his strategy might be, what the strategies for all the other cars might be. He was the first one in the strategy to meet and go, have you looked at the race in 19, whatever it is, and what happened there? And I was like, I have no idea what happened in that race.
He loves his history, doesn't he?
Exactly. You know, like, but he really understood, and he'd often come up with quite good suggestions really about, well, what if this car goes very early or that? And he really got what we were trying to achieve, I think, a lot of the time in terms of strategy and what the implications might be. And I didn't work with him for very long, but, you know, the first person I worked with was Jensen in 2014 as a performance engineer, not as a strategist. But I guess maybe because he was the first, I was struck by how much he took in from the TV. You know, he'd come back in after a qualifying lap or whatever, and he'd say, oh, I seen that XYZ happened. And how did you see that? And he'd be like, oh, on the TV. I was like, why?
On the track.
Wow. So the guys, particularly when they're straight, are able to take in, like, a straight for us, we'd be holding on for dear life, right? Or they're doing their switch positions or whatever. But for those guys, like, their mental capacity when they're doing that is so vast that they're just literally looking at the TV going, oh yeah, I've seen that accident. It's like, how on earth did you see that accident? But that, I think that struck me as just the mental capacity that these guys have.
So mental capacity, but also intelligence. I mean, yeah, they tend to be, as athletes,
yeah,
on a sliding scale of the most intelligent athletes, Grand Prix drivers would be pretty high at the top. But I guess what marks out the really special ones and the champions is the ones who are, like Schumacher was, they're just always looking for that little extra detail. And his, a lot of his career, obviously, with Ross Brawn, that's when strategy became a thing, really. It's when I was in the pit lane with ITV. Yeah. It became, because refueling was part of the story there. But that's when it started to be a really big part of the narrative, didn't it?
And I think it's things like, you know, like Sebastian came from Ferrari to us, and just pushing very minor things, every little things, like, although we sometimes think that the gaps or whatever they are in qualifying, tiny fractions make a difference. Tiny, tiny fractions in that qualifying lap or in the race or in pit stop decisions, whatever. So every little thing that you can improve, although it doesn't bring direct lap time, if it improves decision making or the stress level on the pit wall or your software, whatever it is, then it leads to better decisions. So he was one that was always trying to find the next, oh, why don't you do this? Or why don't you do this? Or, like, as a really stupid example, he changed how we did our meetings and how we showed data to drivers, which is like, this makes a lot more sense than what we were doing before.
Well, Bernie, listen, I could talk to you all day about this. It's one of my favourite topics, and thank you so much for sharing time and your insights, and good luck with your book. I don't think you need my luck. It seems to be selling very well, but
thank you.
Thank you, and we look forward to hearing a lot more from you on TV.
Thank you for having me.